Hi, and good morning, everyone. This is Chaplain Michael Kindom here at Abida Health Adventist Medical Center in Hinsdale. Welcome you back to our weekly chapel. We're so glad for you to join us, and today we're going to be singing the hymn, Take the Name of Jesus With You, song number 235. We'll sing one verse. Jesus with you, child of sorrow and of woe. It will joy and comfort give you. Take it then where'er you go. Precious name, oh how sweet, hope of earth and joy of heaven. Precious name, oh, how sweet, hope of earth and joy of heaven. And now let us enjoy some special music by our friend Victor Moreno. Now at this time, I'd like to invite you to join me as we pray. Gracious God, Father in heaven, we thank you so very much for this time that we can open your word and be inspired to be better servants for you and for our fellow human beings. We pray for a blessing upon this message today, and on everyone who is listening. In your most holy name, amen. Today's scripture reading is from Galatians chapter 6, verse 7, and I'm reading from the New International Version. That's again Galatians chapter 6 and verse 7. The Bible reads, "Do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows." One day, a poor boy who was selling goods from door to door to pay his way through school found he had only one thin dime left, and he was hungry. He decided he would ask for a meal and at the next house. However, he lost his nerve when a lovely young lady opened the door. Instead of a meal, he asked for a drink of water. She thought he looked hungry, so brought him a large glass of milk. He drank it so slowly and then asked, "How much do I owe you?" "You don't owe me anything," she replied. "Mother has taught us never to accept pay for a kindness." He said, "Then I thank you from my heart." As Howard Kelly left that house, he not only felt stronger physically, but his faith in God and man was strong also. He had been ready to give up and quit. Many years later, that same young woman became critically ill. The local doctors were baffled. They finally sent her to the big city where they called in specialists to study her rare disease. Dr. Howard Kelly was called in for the consultation. When he heard the name of the town she came from, a strange light filled his eyes. Immediately, he rose and went down the hall of the hospital to her room. Dressed in his doctor's gown, he went in to see her. He recognized her at once. He went back to the consultation room, determined to do his best to save her life. From that day, he gave special attention to her case. After a long struggle, the battle was won. Dr. Kelly requested the business office to pass the final bill to him for approval. He looked at it, then wrote something on the edge, and the bill was sent to her room. She feared to open it, for she was sure it would take the rest of her life to pay for it all. Finally, she looked, and something caught her attention on the side of the bill. She read these words, "Paid in full with one glass of milk," signed Dr. Howard Kelly. This story is based on actual incidents in the life of Dr. Howard Kelly, who in 1889 went to become one of the founding physicians of the very prestigious Johns Hopkins School of Medicine in Baltimore, Maryland, which was the very first medical research university in the United States. This story was not a singular event. It was well known that Dr. Kelly not only made it a practice to write off the bills of less fortunate patients, but for years he also paid the salary of a nurse to visit and care for his patients that were less fortunate. This is a remarkable story of justice, compassion, and kindness repaid. Again, coming back to the Word of God, I read now from 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 6. "Remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously." The Bible is teaching us today that our acts, our decisions, and our deeds, no matter how small they are today, are seeds that grow into great results in the future. So it is my hope and prayer for us today that with all our small acts, decisions, and deeds today, we will sow seeds of generosity, of kindness, and charity. And we will never know how great the harvest will be in the future. Will you pray with me? Gracious God, we thank you so very much for your great love and provision for us in our lives, that you provide for all of our needs, and that we are so blessed that we have places to live in, we have food on our tables, we have clothing on our backs. And Lord, we pray that you will help us and use us today to be stewards of generosity, that we can bless others so that they in turn may also be a blessing in the world. This we pray in your most holy name. Amen. I would like to invite you now to sing with us our closing verse from the hymn, Take the Name of Jesus With You, and we will sing verse number 4.
At the name of Jesus bow, crown him when our journey is complete. Precious name, oh how sweet, hope of earth and joy of heaven. Precious name, oh how sweet, hope of earth and joy of heaven.
May the Lord bless and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
We all experience a wide range of emotions. Joy at the birth of a baby, the thrill of a new adventure, sadness over a missed opportunity, and yes, there's anger. For some, it is sparked by something small and slowly grows over time. And for others, it explodes and takes over our lives. This was the case for my friend John, who told me he didn't know if he could push through his anger. He gave me permission to share his story. A few months ago, John got that dreaded phone call that his dad was being taken by ambulance to the hospital. The next morning, his condition worsened, and now his father was in ICU and on a ventilator. John wanted to be there with him in the room, but he couldn't be. So he had to sit outside in his car, in the parking lot, waiting, helpless and hopeless. It wasn't long before his dad passed away. John felt like he had failed his father. He told me he wasn't sure if he could ever get over the anger about not being there when his dad passed away. Have you ever felt anger like my friend John? You know, I have an air compressor in my garage, and it is equipped with a safety release valve. Basically keeps it from exploding. Here's how it works. Air goes into the tank, and once it reaches a certain level, you hear this sound. Psst. That's the release valve shutting it off. That is a wonderful sound. On the other hand, if the safety valve didn't exist, and the tank overfilled with air, I can tell you, I would not want to be standing in my garage when it explodes. Anger is a natural emotion. In and of itself, it's not bad or unhealthy. However, it is a response emotion, a secondary emotion, so that where you would find anger, you will also find unresolved hurt and pain. And for John, he discovered that he had held himself responsible for his dad's passing. And once he began to forgive himself for something he couldn't even control, he began to heal. Whatever the reasons behind anger, restoration is possible. Here are a few ways to activate that safety valve that God has given to us to keep anger from turning into bitterness. Number one, when you start to feel angry, just slow down and take some deep breaths. And then at some point, secondly, journal. Consider writing your feelings down. This was key in helping my friend John process his feelings and begin healing. Thirdly, think before you speak. This may help you avoid saying something that you could regret later. Number four, forgive yourself and forgive others. And finally, reach out for professional help if you feel you need to. That is a true sign of strength. Today, I invite you to receive God into your heart. He can bring you peace. Whatever the emotions you're feeling, whatever you're going through right now, your God, your Father, can give you healing.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. We seem to be doing a lot of waiting lately. And I don't just mean the usual waiting we've all grown accustomed to, like the DMV or a car repair shop. We're waiting on the vaccine, waiting to see friends and family again, waiting for life to return to normal. If you're like most, waiting or living in that space between what was and what will soon be isn't easy. It can create anxiety, fear, depression. So what do we do? Easter gives us the answer. On a Saturday more than 2,000 years ago, Jesus' disciples knew the pain of being between what was and what will soon be. They felt the pain of loss, the fear and anxiety of watching their Lord and leader die on a cross. They had no idea what would come next. Little did they know, they are on the cusp of the greatest event in Earth's history. Sunday morning, Christ would walk out of the tomb he was laid to rest in just 2 days before. He would conquer our greatest enemy, death, and give us a living hope of eternal life. While right now, it may seem like a great chasm is before you, or that a high mountain stands in your way, the reality is, you and I have reason to hope. God has something better for us. Jesus, our living
hope.
How great the chasm that laid between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. And through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. Claim on me. Then came the moment.